In the last session, if you observe it, okay. So as I mentioned it, children, in the last class, we have discussed about cyclic structure of the glucose as well as configuration of the glucose. The same topic we will be continuing it. So we know that glucose is having four chiral carbons. And the number of isomers can be given as 16 isomers, isn't it? And those 16 isomers, if you observe it, among those 16 isomers, 8 are of D isomers. Those are nothing but D configuration, you can say that. And remaining 8 are L isomers. 8 are of D isomers and data of L isomers, a pair from the D and L series constitute an enantiomeric pair. Okay, so one from D and another one from L, which gives you an enantiomer. So like the total 16 isomers are possible. But yesterday I have given few, but I'll be giving total 8 D series of isomers if you observe them. CHO. Hope you remember, yesterday I have given yesterday 3 isomers only. Those are nothing but glucose, galactose and mannose. Those isomers I have given it. No change in it. Simply HOH, simply HOH. This carbohydrate is called as allose. This carbohydrate is called as allose, children. And now just change the second carbon configuration. Change the second carbon configuration. Rest of everything is same. Please copy it. Rest of everything is same. Right, if you observe it, second carbon configuration has been changed, rest of everything has been same, and the first carbohydrate is said to be allose, and the second one is altrose. Second one is altrose, and third one, which is well known and familiar to you, which is well known and familiar to you. This is called as our glucose. This is called as glucose. Now in the same way, if you change the configuration number 2, at carbon number 2, if you change the configuration, H, OH, H, OH, yeah, at carbon number 2 we are changing the configuration, right? So this is called as a mannose. At carbon number 2, both these are of having different configuration at the carbon number 2. That's why glucose and mannose are examples of C2 epimers. That is what I have told you in the last class. All carbohydrates we are not highlighting as per our discussion. According to their importance, we are discussing it. Glucose and mannose are examples of C2 epimers. Epimers are those carbohydrates which shows the difference in the configuration at the second carbon or at any other carbon generally. Difference in the configuration, if it shows at second carbon, those are said to be C2 epimers. If they show difference in the fourth carbon, C4 epimers, of course, that is glucose and galactose. Here, so far, we have written glucose and mannose and another carbohydrate, if you observe it. Please copy it. CH2OH. This is what we have. Just one. Sorry for the interruption. And here HCOH, that is what we can give it. And as well as if you observe that here HOH, rest of everything is same, like first carbohydrate. Only we are changing the fourth carbon we are changing. Rest of everything is same as like first carbohydrate. This is called as a glucose. It is called as a glucose. It is also another carbohydrate can be given, which is of having C6H12O6 only. All of these are D forms only. Observe it. All of these are of D forms only. See, check it here. With this glucose, it is same. It is having same configuration. With the glucose itself, if you observe it, it is having same configuration, but at second carbon, there is a change in configuration. This is called as I-dose. This is called as I-dose, children. Now check it, glucose with the fourth carbon change. Fourth carbon change, if I observe it. Fourth carbon change, if I observe it, it is the fourth carbon, you can give it. At this fourth carbon, difference must be observed. Change in the configuration, OH and H. Rest of everything is same. Right? This is said to be galactose. It is called as galactose. So yesterday also I have told you very clearly, glucose and galactose are examples of C4 epimers. Glucose and galactose are examples of C4 epimers can be given, right? So allose, altrose, glucose, mannose, gulose, and idose, galactose. And one more is also there, that is tallose. At allose is there, no? Allose, all the carbons, so if you write it reverse, except last chiral carbon, right? Last chiral carbon must be having the D configuration only. Then that is said to be tallose. That is eighth carbohydrate, which is of having a D configuration. Please copy it first. I'll give it that eighth one also. Another carbohydrate, that is eighth carbohydrate, I'm giving it here. CH2OH. So this carbon, there is no difference. When it compared to allose, totally reverse. Remaining all groups must be on the reverse. Check it. This is said to be tallose. This carbohydrate is called as tallose. Another diisomer. At highest chiral carbon number, if you observe it everywhere, OH group is on the right hand side. OH group is on the right hand side. So all of these are having a D configuration. All of these are having a D configuration can be given. So now one D isomer and another L isomer. Okay, both these constitute one enantiomeric pair. Right? So total 8 enantiomeric pairs will be there. 8 enantiomeric pairs means 16 isomers. So 4 chiral carbons, 16 stereoisomers are possible for carbohydrate which is having molecular formula C6H12O6, but among them the most familiar to us is glucose among monosaccharides, that too among aldohexoses. All these are examples of aldohexoses only. We will be continuing with the cyclic structure of the glucose only. Yesterday also we had discussed about cyclic structure of the glucose, a ring structure of the glucose with the help of Haworth projections, isn't it? Now we know that D glucose is in equilibrium with alpha D glucose as well as with beta D glucose. Alpha D glucose as well as with beta D glucose. But at equilibrium, how much percentage of alpha D glucose is there and how much percentage of beta D glucose is there? Beta D glucose is up to around 64% and alpha D glucose is up to 36% will be there. Means percentage of alpha D glucose is lesser compared to the beta D glucose. That you can understand with the help of chair forms of this alpha as well as beta D glucose. Chair forms are possible because of conformational isomerism. Because of conformational isomerism. So if you write that, we know that C1 and C5 carbon, C1 and C5 carbon of the glucose are connected through an oxygen, right? So that is nothing but hemiacetal linkage, which forms a six-membered ring. That six-membered ring, for suppose, if you write it in chair form, that means pyranose form of the glucose. Pyranose form of alpha and beta D glucose can be represented in chair form. Can be represented in chair form. But suppose if you write it in chair form, for alpha D glucose, as well as beta D glucose, we are giving it. Only they can, you can observe the change in configuration at first carbon, rest of the carbon configurations are same only. CH2OH. So here itself, if you observe that, this is alpha D glucose or alpha D glucopyranose. And it is beta D glucopyranose. It is beta D glucopyranose. This I can take it as beta D glucopyranose. In which, if you observe it, this OH, which is present at the equatorial position in chair form. It is present at the equatorial position, whereas this OH is present at the axial position. So the group which is present at the axial position suffers with more repulsions compared to the equatorial position. So that is the reason. So beta D glucopyranose is more stable form. It is more stable form, but this is less stable form. This is less stable form. That is the reason it is existing in the 36, it is existing as 36%. But beta D glucose can exist as 64% because of the stability regions, we can say that. Beta D glucopyranose is more stable. That's why it is present as 64%. Alpha D glucopyranose is less stable, present as 36%. So the stability also can be explained in terms of their positions in the chair form. In chair form, OH group in beta D glucopyranose is present at equatorial position, which suffers with less repulsions. But whereas in alpha D glucopyranose, that OH group is present at axial position, first carbon. Why? Because both these are examples of anomers. They differ in the configuration at C1. And at that anomeric carbon, that OH group position only decides the stability of both of these isomers. Hope it is clear. Now, if you observe that, even in glucose, if you observe that, in glucose, C1 and C4 also can be connected. Even C1 and C4 can be connected through hemiacetal linkase. Right, that is also possibility is there. But if it forms hemiacetal linkase, then it gives a 5-membered ring. Generally, 5-membered rings can be represented with the furan. 5-membered rings can be represented with furan. Right, and the corresponding glucose forms are said to be alpha D glucofuranose and beta D glucofuranose. Observe those structures. This is nothing but furan. Hope you know the structure of pyran ring. Now it is furan. So at first carbon only there is a difference, you can observe it. OH will be here, H will be here. And here you can say that H will be here and OH will be here. And rest of everything is same for both. It is OH, H, and it is H, OH. And here you can observe OH and CHOH and CH2OH. It is OH, this H, CHOH, CH2OH. So this is called as alpha D glucofuranose. And it is called as beta D glucofuranose. But we know that out of 5-membered rings and 6-membered rings, which are more stable? Which are more stable can be given, children? 5-membered rings. Five-membered rings are less stable than 6-membered rings. So that is the reason, okay, it can exist as pyranose form rather than furanose form. But that too, there are specific conditions. At room temperature and above, if you observe that, glucose can exist as pyranose form. Glucose can exist as a pyranose form at room temperature as well as above temperature if it is there. But at 0 degrees Celsius or less than 0 degrees Celsius, glucose exists as a furanose form. Glucose can exist as a furanose form. That is the point of difference. At low temperatures, 0 degrees Celsius or below to it, it can exist as furanose form. At, you know, room temperature and above room temperature, it can exist as a pyranose form. So, but which is more stable form? In the sense, pyranose form is more stable form compared to the furanose form. Please copy it.
1 minute, can you go back?
Yeah, 1 sec. Fine. Next, formation of glycosides. So formation of glycosides means glucose, whenever if it react with alcohol, in the presence of HCl, it forms hemiacetal. And then if it react with another mole of alcohol in the presence of HCl, it forms acetal. Acetal is nothing but which is having ether linkages. And these acetals are said to be glycosides. So if I take alpha D glucose in the form of hemiacetal structure, this is what I have given for hemiacetal structure. isn't it? This is called as hemiacetal, which is formed by reaction of the glucose with alcohol. Reaction of glucose with alcohol, and it is said to be alpha-D glucose. Alpha-D glucose. Once again, if it react with methanol in the presence of HCl. Hemiacetal is reacting with methanol in the presence of HCl. Then anomeric carbon. Anomeric carbon is first carbon. Anomeric carbon is first carbon. That can react with that methanol in the presence of HCl. And it forms another ether linkage. Hemiacetal is consisting of alcohol and ether. Alcohol as well as ether. But here it is consisting of ether, both ether linkages at one carbon. At one carbon already we have ether linkage, one ether linkage in the form of hemiacetal. And another OH is there that can combine with alcohol and it forms OH. OC is this one. It forms OCH3 and now it is connected to fifth carbon with another ether linkage. There are two ether linkages and that is said to be acetal. Acetals are nothing but glycosides which are formed from glucose. So rest of everything is same. Rest of everything is, it is CH2OH. Now this is called as methyl glycoside. Methyl glycoside. So whenever glucose if it react with methanol in the presence of HCl, in such cases, it will form finally acetal. This acetal is said to be an example of glycoside. Then it is said to be methyl glycoside, we can say that. And moreover, if you observe that, moreover, here it is reacting with this OH only reacting with the CH3OH and it is forming OCH3. But remaining OH groups are, other OH groups are not alkylated. But if you would like to, alkylate the other OH groups, in such cases, you have to use dimethyl sulfate, you have to use it. So HCOCH3. So this is nothing but methyl glycoside. And this methyl glycoside, once again, if it is reacting with dimethyl sulfate, CH3 twice SO4, then in that case, all of these OH groups also can be converted into, CH, and this can be taken as OCH3. Alkylated. It can be alkylated. That H can be replaced with the CH3 group if it is alkylated. And it is OCH3. And it is OCH3. And CH. It is CH2OH. Yeah. So if you observe it, here one methyl group. And it is one methyl group. Already one methyl group is there. O methyl groups are there. Then if you write that, what we will have here, 2, 3, if you consider it, and this one also can be replaced, CH2O, that hydrogen also can be replaceable. So then you'll get CH2OCH3. So what we are going to get it here, 2, 3, 4, and 6. Fifth is already involved in hemiacetal linkage. So 2, 3, 4, 6. So what we can say that at O position, we have methyl groups. How many are there? 4. So tetra O methyl glycoside. methyl glycoside. So it is nothing but already methyl glycoside only. That methyl glycoside only can be treated with dimethyl sulfate. It can be converted into 2, 3, 4, 6 tetraomethyl methyl glycoside. Right? So alpha D glucose can be converted into methyl glycosides. Right? And if this methyl glycoside is called as alpha methyl glycoside. But suppose if I take beta D glucose, it will be converted into beta methyl glycoside. So please copy it and we'll talk about the stability of these type of glucosides also. Stability of alpha and beta methyl glycosides. So far, if you observe it, if I take alpha D glucose and beta D glucose, which is more stable, means what do you say?
Beta D glucose.
But here, if you observe it, alpha methyl glycoside is more stable. Alpha methyl glycoside is more stable than beta methyl glycoside. It is due to anomeric effect. So what is meant by this anomeric effect? Anomeric effect means preference to occupy axial position rather than equatorial position by any group with lone pair is called as anomeric effect. That effect is called as anomeric effect. So what is happening here? So preference to occupy axial position rather than equatorial position by any group with lone pair, then it is said to be anomeric effect. Because of this anomeric effect only, alpha methyl glycoside is more stable than beta methyl glycoside. So if you observe the chair conformation, once again, I'm not going to write it. So here, what you'll be getting? Instead of H, we'll be getting OCH3. This is beta methyl glycoside. But here, okay, if you replace H with the CH3, OCH3, it is alpha methyl glycoside. But this is equatorial position, as you know that is equatorial position, right? And at that equatorial position, you can see that OCH3. So at equatorial position, what will happen? This lone pair and this oxygen lone pair will undergo repulsions. You might ask me, sir, OH is also there, no, won't we have okay repulsions in that case? But here electron density is increasing with respect to methyl group. So methyl group electron density is increasing. So because of that, repulsions will be maximum. So due to that, when it comes to beta methyl glycoside, its stability decreases. But here OH group is preferred to occupy at axial position only to avoid that repulsions. That effect is called as anomeric effect. So because of that here, in case of alpha methyl glycoside, it is OCH3 that is present at axial position to minimize the less repulsions. It prefers to occupy at axial positions only. But in case of beta methyl glycoside, OCH3 is present at equatorial position. It will undergo repulsions with this acetyl oxygen, we can say that. Right? So because of that, beta methyl glycoside is less stable compared to alpha methyl glycoside. So it is another point to be discussed over here. Okay, please copy this. It's the next monosaccharide, molecular formula C6H12O6. It is called as levulose and it is a levorotatory sugar. So it is also can be prepared by hydrolysis of sucrose, C12H22O11. If it undergo hydrolysis in the presence of an acid, it produces C6H12O6 plus C6H12O6. So that is glucose and fructose. Same preparation method can be given for both. And moreover, it is an example of keto exose. Means 6-carbon carbohydrate having ketone as function group. And if you observe open chain structure of the fructose, CH2OH, C double bond. As we know that ketone is non-terminal functional group. That's why it must be placed at the second position. So it is HCOH, it is HCOH, and it is OH. Point of difference we can understand very clearly with the help of this structure. And it is said to be D-fructose. Because OH group is on the right hand side, hence it is said to be D. Minus means optical rotation, it rotates the PPL to the left side, hence it is said to be levorotate. Hence, that's why it is also said to be levulose. And it is the open chain structure. And similarly, if you observe the formation of hemiacetal linkase, so how can you give it? That means cyclic structure or ring structure of the fructose. So in glucose children, if you observe it, that C1, that means carbon number 1 is connected to carbon number 5. And it has given hemiacetal form or cyclic structure to the fructose. Sorry, cyclic structure to the glucose, that we know. But when it comes to fructose, instead of C1, C2 will undergo this reaction. That means ketone is there, no? This ketone interacts with this OH group and it forms cyclic hemiacetal. So that can be given it as CH2OH. Already CH2OH is there. This bond you can polarize it. And it is O minus and it is H plus. So H plus can be shifted over here. And then O can be connected to the carbon. Then it becomes OH. CH2OH. And it forms a hemiacetal linkage. Right? So this is said to be alpha D fructose. But these structures are similar to furan ring, as I told you, right? So the similar structure can be given with the furan ring. Then such type of structures are said to be furanose structures. And furanose structure, here OH group is on the right hand side. It is 1 plus carbon number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. So OH group is on the right hand side. That means it should be placed at bottom. Okay. And rest of everything is same for both alpha and beta. So carbon number also if you indicate 1, it is 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. So this is called as alpha D fructofuranose. Alpha D fructofuranose. That is called as alpha D fructofuranose. Okay. So in the same way, if you observe it, in the same way, you can give it for beta D fructose also. In that case, carbon number, if you observe it, at carbon number 2, OH group is on the left hand side. It forms a hemiacetal linkage. It is H So this is said to be beta D fructose. And if you write, it is equal to furano structure. That furano structure, if you write it, it will be CH2OH. It will be OH. H here, OH here, and OH, H, it is H, CH2OH. So this is called as beta D fructofuranose. Beta D fructofuranose can be given, right? So it is structure of fructose. Please copy it. Observe it carefully. Very important for competitive. Properties of glucose and fructose. Properties of glucose and fructose. A few properties are almost same, and the properties which are different, we are discussing it clearly, right? So for suppose, if I observe first property, that is glucose or fructose, when it react with the HI in the presence of red phosphorus, it can form N-hexane only. There is no difference in it. Both are having same molecular formula. When they react with HI in the presence of red phosphorus, it will give N-hexane. There is no change in it. That point is clear. And next, glucose or fructose, when it react with the hydroxylamine as well as with the hydroxylamine, it forms oxymes only, respective oxymes only can be formed. Same way, glucose or fructose, when it react with HCN, respective cyanohydrin only can be formed. There is no difference in it. And glucose or fructose, when it react with the acetic anhydride, it forms pentaacetate. Respective pentaacetate can be formed. Glucose pentaacetate in case of glucose, fructose pentaacetate in case of fructose. So there is no difference in this case also, right? But if you observe, bromine water being a mild oxidizing agent, it cannot oxidize fructose because ketone group is there. Ketone group cannot be oxidized with mild oxidizing agents. It requires a strong oxidizing agents. But in case of strong oxidizing agent, if it is there, then reactions will be different. Rest of all the reactions will be same, like this, whatever the reactions I have given it. But what are the reactions which are different? Let's see those reactions now. Reaction number 5, that is reaction with sodium mercury solution or LiAlH4, lithium aluminum hydride, which can act as a reducing agent, NaBH4, which also can act as a reducing agent. So in case of glucose, if you observe it, so I'm writing on the right side, okay? So glucose structure, we know that, CHO. And then rest of everything, it will be CHOH four times only. This will be CH2OH. If it react with NaHg solution, or you can take lithium aluminum hydride, then CHO group, aldehyde can be reduced to primary alcohol. So this lithium aluminum hydride is an example of a reducing agent. That's why aldehyde group has been reduced to primary alcohol. So CHOH four times and CH2OH, you'll get it. This is called as a sorbitol. But if you take fructose, what is the structure can be given? CHO, C double bond. So C double bond, rest of everything is same, that is CHOH thrice, CH2OH. This is fructose. if it react with sodium mercury solution or lithium aluminum hydride, what will happen? Double bond can be converted into single bond. One side H can be added, another side OH can be added. Then it forms CHO, C, OH, H, CH, OH, thrice, CH2OH, right? Plus, same thing I can write it as, the aldehyde also has been converted. Sorry, I forgot to mention it, CHO. CH2OH, and then C, it can be written as H, it is OH. I'm changing the configuration at the second carbon. CHOH thrice, and it is CH2OH. So this is said to be sorbitol. And it is said to be mannitol. It is said to be mannitol. Now my question is, out of these two reactions, right, reaction with NaHG solution with lithium aluminum hydride or sodium borohydride, if you take it, which one can generate new chiral centers, glucose or fructose? Which one is generating new chiral centers?
Fructose
is generating new chiral center. That's that type of questions also they can ask. So here what we can say that, so you can say that a new asymmetric carbon, a new asymmetric carbon is generated. Is generated, right? Please copy it. What is that? Reaction with the concentrated nitric acid. Reaction with concentrated nitric acid. Of course, it is an example of strong oxidizing agent. So now tell me, in case of glucose, anyone can respond. Glucose, if it react with concentrated nitric acid, what it will give?
Saccharic acid.
Perfect. It will give saccharic acid. This reaction, hope you know it already. No need to write it. Now the question is, will fructose behave in the same manner? Will it give saccharic acid?
No, sir.
Why?
No, sir.
Why it will not give saccharic acid?
Because it has a ketone group, while glucose has a aldehyde group.
Yes, yes. But suppose if you observe that fructose, in case of fructose, there is a functional group ketone. That's why both they do not behave in similar manner. Right? So now, if you write the structure, CH2OH, C double bond O, this is the fructose structure can be given. OH and H. If it is treated with a concentrated nitric acid, it is HNO3, it is concentrated nitric acid, it will give two products. COOH, COOH. This is nothing but oxalic acid. That is nothing but oxalic acid. And as well as you will get alcohol can be oxidized to carboxylic acid. Ketone also can be oxidized to carboxylic acid. So another one, what will you be getting in here? COOH, COOH, H, COOH, H, and COOH. This is called as a tartaric acid. This is called as a tartaric acid. Hope you observe the point of difference clearly. The point of difference between glucose oxidation and fructose oxidation. Glucose, whenever it is oxidizing with concentrated nitric acid, it will give saccharic acid. Whereas fructose, it will give oxalic acid and tartaric acid. It is the point of difference between glucose and fructose. Please copy it. Next reaction number, seven. Most important reaction, children, this is for JE point of view. That is reaction with phenyl hydrogen. Reaction with the phenyl hydrogen. The essence of organic chemistry can be enjoyed in this type of reactions. Okay, you can take that flavor. Formation of ozone. Formation of ozone. Or else you can say that ozone test. Formation of ozone or ozone test. So now, glucose, fructose, both they can form ozones. So whenever glucose and fructose, if they react with phenyl hydrazine, they can form yellow color crystalline derivative. That yellow color crystalline derivative indicates the presence of glucose and fructose. Indicates the presence of glucose and fructose, that yellow color crystalline ozone. So what is meant by phenyl hydrazine? Hydrazine, you are well aware of it. NH2, NH2. This is hydrazine. In that, one hydrogen must be replaced and place phenyl. That is C6H5. This is called phenyl hydrazine. Observe it carefully. So now, CHO. Please allow me to write it like that. CH double bond O. CHOH four times. And CH2OH. So this is called glucose. Hydrazine. H2N. NH C6H5. A few people will write it same as pH also, right? pH means phenyl. This is phenyl hydrazine. Then what will happen? H2 can be removed over there. H2O can be removed over there. Then it forms CH double bond N NH C6H5. And the next carbon, if you observe it, we have to elaborate it for this especially. We have to elaborate it. CH2OH. This is OH. And it is OH. Sorry. Yeah, this is H. And it is HOH. OH, H. This will be H and OH. Now we got a double bond over there. That double bond polarizes it towards the nitrogen. And this bond can be polarized. Obviously, carbon takes the electron from the hydrogen only. Hydrogen is the core element we used to discuss generally. And then this nitrogen, this carbon is getting positive charge. This carbon is getting negative charge. So it forms a double bond over there. And which is having H, this double bond becomes single bond. And this nitrogen is getting minus, no? This H, we are removing it as H plus, no? Will be attracted over there. So it will be NH, NH, C6H5. Rest of everything is same. OH. Right? So allow me to write it remaining like this. We won't disturb the remaining chain. CH2OH. Is it clear? So then, as a next step. So what will happen? As a next step, you can polarize this bond. And then if you polarize that towards NHC6H5, and then you can polarize the bond in this direction. So, and similarly, you can polarize the bond in this direction. Observe it carefully, right? So this nitrogen, which I'm highlighting it, getting plus, this carbon is getting minus. Then what you are going to get it? HC double bond NH. This bond anyway, we have broken. This H can be migrated to this nitrogen. So I can remove C6H5NH2. What I got here? Aniline. This compound is called as aniline. And this double bond becomes a single bond. And this carbon is getting plus. This oxygen is getting minus. So it forms C double bond O. Rest of everything is same. CHOH thrice. CH2OH. Continuation, please allow me to write it here. Yeah, it's continuation. And it reacts with the C6H5 NH NH2. Second mole of phenyl hydrazine. It is a second mole of phenyl hydrazine. Then here also, what will happen? In this case, next step, what we will do? We have removed aniline here. And then we got this product. And then second mole. So this NH2 and this H can be removed. If you remove NH2 and H as NH3, then what you are going to get it? Observe it carefully. HC double bond N. This H gone. Connected with this NH, C6H5. And C double bond O, rest of everything is same. CHOH thrice CH2OH. Is it clear? And now as a next step, C6H5, NH, NH2. It is third mole. Observe it carefully. It is third mole of the phenyl hydrogen. It is third mole of the phenyl hydrogen. In this case, what will happen? Ketone will react. This O and this H2 can be removed as water molecule. Then HC double bond NNH C6H5. And C double bond NNH C6H5. Rest of everything is same. Your water molecule, you have removed it. And then CHOH thrice, and it is CH2OH. This is called as glucosazone. Generally, it is said to be osazone, but this osazone is formed from glucose. That's why it is said to be glucosazone, and it is yellow crystalline derivative. What is this called as? Yellow crystalline derivative. Hope you got it, everyone. It is yellow crystalline derivative. So glucose and fructose, both they react with phenyl hydrogen, they can form osazone. Now tell me, how many moles of phenyl hydrogen has been used to react with glucose to form osazone?
Two.
Huh?
Three, sir.
Three moles. It is first mole and it is second mole. Where is that? Okay, yeah. It is second mole of phenyl hydrogen and it is third mole. Very, very important integer type question in JEE. Glucose react with X mole of phenyl hydrogen gives osazone. What is the value of X? That X value is supposed to be 3. Okay, please copy it.
So what is X?
H2 and O can be removed as water molecule. And then what it will give? C double bond N, NH, C6H5. And rest of everything is same, no? CHOH thrice CH2OH. First mole is done. Now do some modifications here. Polarize the bond towards nitrogen and takes the electron from carbon, takes the electron from hydrogen. Then it forms a bond here. CHOH is already there. There is a double bond C. The single bond that N accept the hydrogen, sorry, NH C6H5. And then CHOH thrice CH2OH. And now what will happen? You can take C6H5, NH, NH2. Right? Just wait. Yeah. This is what we got it, right? This is the product what we got it. Now what we are supposed to do, this OH bond is there, no? This bond, you polarize it first. And then same, we have removed aniline, no? This bond, you can polarize it. This bond, you can polarize it. So same way, C6H5 NH2 removed. We have removed aniline first. And then it forms a double bond there, CH double bond O, and it becomes single bond, C double bond NH. And then rest of everything is same. Same itself, CH double bond, so CH4H thrice CH2OH. Now take another mole of phenyl hydrogen, C6H5, NH, NH2. This time what will happen? This H2. And that H2, okay, we'll remove, next what we have removed there. As a next step, what we have removed there? Ammonia, right? So same thing, you do it here also. This NH2 combines with this H. I'll be writing here continuation of this CH double bond O C double bond N. H has been removed as ammonia, and rest of everything can attack over there. N, NH, C6H5, CHOH thrice, connected with CH2OH. Down, I don't have space there. And then next step, another mole of phenyl hydrogen. C6H5, NH, NH2. And then this oxygen, this hydrogen removed as water, and it forms same like previous one. So check it at the end, what we have written, same. CH double bond N, NH, C6H5. And then C double bond N, NH, C6H5. And rest of everything is same, CHOH thrice, CH2OH. This is called as fructose zone. This is
number of moles should be same or different.
Same. Fructose zone. Yellow crystalline derivative. Glucose and fructose will give same type of OSA zone. Check it.
So similar.
So in this reaction with phenyl hydrogen, glucose react with phenyl hydrogen. It forms glucose OSA zone and fructose OSA zone. That is yellow crystalline derivative. And further reaction does not extend it beyond the second carbon because of the formation of this product. It is stabilized by intramolecular hydrogen bonding, and it can form six membered ring. That's why it cannot extend it. So this is the reaction what we have discussed so far. Now reaction number 8, that is reaction with the please, okay, mute. Who's that? Chetan. Okay, fine. So reaction with
mistake.
Fine. Okay. Reaction with the Fehling solution. Reaction with the Fehling solution. Just hold on.
Yes.
Reaction with the Fehling solution and Tollens reagent. Reaction with the Fehling solution and Tollens reagent. Right. So now in case of glucose, if you observe it, glucose reduces both. Both in the sense failing solution, Tollens reagent. I'll write it as FS and I'll write this as TR for sake of convenience. Reduces both FS and Tollens reagent. So CHOH four times and CH2OH. This is our glucose. If it react with the Fehling solution, and it can be converted into COOH, CHOH four times, CH2OH, plus you'll get Cu2O. Children, it is a characteristic reaction of aldehydes. Generally, ketones will not give this reaction. Ketones will not give a test for the Fehling solution as well as for Tollens reagent. So now with the same, if you observe it, glucose is reacting with the Fehling solution is done. Now with the Tollens reagent. Tollens reagent, we can take it as AgNH3 twice whole raised to plus. And then what you are going to get it? COOH. Same thing, CHOH four times, CH2OH. This is called gluconic acid, of course. And you will get AZ. It is also said to be silver mirror test. Of course, will be discussed in aldehydes and ketones. It is also said to be silver mirror test. You got gluconic acid. So when glucose is reacting with Tollens reagent, it forms gluconic acid. Both these reactions are indicating the presence of aldehyde functional group in glucose that we had already discussed. Hope it is clear for you, right? Now, the question if you observe it, fructose, if I take it, will it reduce the Fehling solution and Tollens reagent? Will fructose reduce the Tollens reagent and as well as Fehling solution? That is my question.
No, sir.
Very good. So, fructose do not reduce the Tollens reagent or Fehling solution. Why? Why it cannot reduces?
It is a ketone, sir.
It is a ketone. Very good. But actually fructose reduces. Right? So, fructose can reduces. Answer is correct. Your answer is correct. Not an issue. Fructose can reduces both failing solution and tollens reagent. Tollens reagent, even though it is a ketose, because both these reactions takes place in alkaline medium. Both these reactions, actually these two reactions takes place in alkaline medium. Right? So, in alkaline medium, fructose rearranges to glucose and mannose and gives positive test. But generally fructose is not supposed to give the test for the tollens reagent as well as failing solution, because it is ketose. Despite of it is having keto group, but it is giving positive test to the tollens reagent failing solution in alkaline medium, right? So in alkaline medium, it can be rearranged to glucose and mannose and it gives positive test. It is called as very interesting name, Lobry, De Bruyne, Van Ekenstein rearrangement. Lobry, De Bruyne, Van Ekenstein rearrangement. This rearrangement is called as Lobry, De Bruyne, Van Ekenstein rearrangement. Because of this rearrangement only, fructose is in equilibrium with glucose and mannose. So what is the formula after fructose? We know that C6H12O6 structure, you know that CH. This I can write it as CH2OH, right? And C double bond O, it will be CHOH thrice CH2OH. I can polarize the bond in this direction. If I polarize this carbon, gets positive charge. So polarize the bond in this direction. So this reaction anyway is taking place in alkaline medium, OH minus, and then it will be CH. So it is minus and plus forms a bond, COH, and already OH is there. Hope you understand the rearrangement. CHOH thrice CH2OH. Now this bond, you can polarize it towards oxygen, and then you can polarize the bond towards carbon, and then this H can be removed as H plus, that can combine with carbon. Now it is in equilibrium with, check it carefully everyone, C, it becomes double bond O, it is H, this double bond becomes single bond C, connected with OH and connected with H, yes or no? And remaining what is there? CHOH thrice and CH2OH. Could you please tell me what is this called as? Anyone?
Glucose.
Yes. So fructose has been changed to glucose in alkaline medium. That's why it is responding to the tollens test as well as Fehring's test. But as well as along with that, what it will form? Mannose also can be formed. Mannose is epimer. Same thing happen, CH double bond O, C this side H, other side you can give it as OH. This is said to be mannose. Because of this rearrangement only, even fructose, though it is a ketose, it also can respond to the tolerance test as well as for Fehling's solution. Hope it is clear for everyone. Yes or no?
Yes.
Next, reaction number 9. Reaction with the HiO4. HiO4 is called as periodic acid. Periodic acid. So periodic acid is an example of oxidizing agent, of course. It is an example of oxidizing agent. In case of glucose, what is the reaction can be given? Aldehyde, CHO, on top CHO, down CH2OH. First two carbons are same here, and here OH, here H, and here H, here OH. This is said to be glucose. If it react with HiO4, it can be converted into HCOOH and HCHO. Formic acid and formaldehyde. So cleavage of the CC bond takes place. That is a specific action of iodic acid. For cleavage of a CC bond, this CC bond can be cleaved, this CC bond can be cleaved, this can be cleaved, and this can be cleaved. These can give formic acid, but primary alcoholic group can give HCHO. So 5 moles of formic acid can be formed. So total, how many CC bonds are cleaving? 5 CC bonds are cleaving. That's why we require 5 moles of periodic acid. But when it comes to fructose, in case of fructose, CH2OH, C double bond O, it is CH2OH. Whenever it is reacting with the HiO, once again, that is a periodic acid. In this case, what is happening? It gives formaldehyde. 2 moles of formaldehyde will be formed. And CO2 you'll get it. And as well as same like this, 3HCOOH. This can be converted into formaldehyde. And this can be converted into formaldehyde. These three groups can be converted into formic acid. And this can be converted into carbon dioxide. Here also we require 5 moles of periodic acid, but products are different if you observe that, right? Overall products are different. Here formaldehyde, formic acid. Here along with formaldehyde, formic acid, we got carbon dioxide. It is also another different reaction between glucose and fructose. Hope it is clear for everyone. So it is all about properties of glucose and fructose. In the next session, we will be continuing with another topic also.